The Original Six, a term well known to hockey historians. The Montreal Canadiens, Toronto Maple Leafs, Boston Bruins, New York Rangers, Detroit Red Wings, and Chicago Blackhawks all captured the attention of sports fans throughout North America.
Well, I was in the record business years ago. A friend of mine and I were having a drink in New York City, and he said, look, I got an extra ticket, you know, to the Garden tonight. The Rangers are playing Montreal. And I said, what's that all about? And he said, well, it's the National Hockey League. Would you like to go with me? I said, yeah, I'll go. I said, you know, I didn't have anything else to do that night. So we went to the old Garden, and I fell in love with the game instantaneously. It was, without question, the greatest spectator sport I had ever seen.
The buildings were full. They'd been full for years and years, and the competition in between the six teams was absolutely at its highest.
Riding that popularity, the time had come to enlarge the six-team league.
I heard that the National Hockey League was expanding from 6 to 12 teams. I thought that it would be great to apply for a franchise.
Ed Snyder, who was working with the Philadelphia Eagles at the time, thought the city of brotherly love would fall for hockey just like he did. But other cities were applying, and Philadelphia's history in hockey was not good.
All the other applicants for the six franchises were from cities that had pretty successful minor league hockey operations for a number of years. Philadelphia was the only one that hadn't. They had seven or eight minor league teams that had failed. There had been one quickly aborted attempt in the 30s to have an NHL team. So there was no history of Philadelphia really being enamored with the sport at all.
However, Ed Snyder, along with Bill Putnam and others, persisted. And on February 9th, 1966, their hard work was rewarded.
This is the year of the great expansion. For the first time, the league will be composed of 12 teams.
Clarence Campbell presided as the teams entered the league. The Philadelphia Flyers, Minnesota North Stars, LA Kings, Pittsburgh Penguins, St. Louis Blues, and the California Seals.
The six new teams would play in one division. But before they took the ice, the Flyers had a lot to do.
One of the requirements for expansion was to have a building that would seat at least 12,000 people. So they built the Spectrum, but it was really the first modern arena of any kind in Philadelphia. And they built the building in a little more than a year, so that it was open in time.
But who would actually take the ice wearing the orange and black? That process was led by GM Bud Poile and head coach Keith Allen.
We basically bought the Quebec Aces, and it gave us people like Andre Lacroix, Jean-Guy Gendron, and other players that were on our original team, and it helped us tremendously. And in addition to that, Keith Allen worked for a year prior to our starting date and scouted the six clubs that were then in existence, and we had, without question, the best expansion draft of any other team.
As far as the goalies were concerned, we thought they were the two best young goalies available, and fortunately we got both of them.
I have to admit, at the time I was disappointed.
Joe was probably the loudest guy in the National Hockey League.
Oh boy, oh boy. That was depression for a while.
Ed Van Emmet had played with Chicago. It was a hard-hitting, rugged defenseman.
Unfortunately, I wound up in Philadelphia.
And Gary Dornhofer was all-out, 100% of every game. He gave everything he had every game.
I was probably like the other guys. I had to look on the map. Where the heck was this Philadelphia?
I was the second player taken by Philadelphia. And I was working for the Public Works Department in British Columbia. And I was flagging people by, I was a flagman. This person got by and says, I hear you just got drafted. And the guy said, I said, what do you mean drafted? Yeah, you get drafted by Philadelphia. I said, what? I went to my boss. I said, oh, God, I got to take the rest of the day off. This is very depressing for me because I thought I had a good year in Boston. And I'd play with Orr. And to go to an expansion team, it was very difficult for me.
My first exposure to Philadelphia was at an Eagles football game. And they introduced a guy on the starting defensive team. I swear to God, all 50,000 stood up and booed. And I said to the people that were there with us, what in God's name did this guy do last week to deserve it? And apparently he had a bad game, and I thought to myself, oh my God, what are we getting ourselves into here?
Perhaps the toughest task facing the new franchise would be winning over the Philly sports fan.
Philadelphia, you know, wasn't really a great hockey town when we first arrived there, and it took a lot of work by Ed Snyder and the rest of his staff to try to get people out there.
When we were brand new and we were ready to play our first game in a few days, the city said, well, we'll have a parade for you, and we'll start at City Hall, and we'll go down Broad Street all the way to the Spectrum. And we said, fantastic.
And the advanced publicity was the Iceman coming, and they had all the players in convertibles, and we were downtown at noon hour.
We paraded down Broad Street, you know, to the Spectrum, but there was one issue. Nobody came.
There were more people in the parade than were watching the parade.
People were looking. They were wondering, who the heck are those guys?
And I said to myself, God, I don't know if we're going to last here very long in Philadelphia.
The team's first game was on the road in Oakland on October the 11th, 1967, where they suffered a 5-1 loss. But it was the home opener that was on everyone's mind.
We played Pittsburgh, and I mean, we had about 7,600 people at the game. The president, Clarence Campbell, was there to drop the puck. And I remember there was a guy named Bill Sullivan, and he was an older guy, and he had come from the Quebec Aces. He scored the winning goal in the game. We won 1-0. And I remember he almost didn't get in the building. The guard didn't think he was a hockey player. He looked too old to be a hockey player.
The Flyers went unrecognized at first.
It was interesting when we started here. I was able to get a lot of tickets, you know, and spread them around to people that I got to know, especially golf professionals. So I kept them supplied in tickets.
If you have a good crowd behind you, it will help you perform better. And that was the part that was a little bit difficult at the beginning.
But the Flyers did perform well, and soon enough, the fans were filling the Spectrum.
We got a pair of tickets, went to the game, and really enjoyed it. And we ended up buying season tickets. Now, a season ticket in those days was less than $100.
What it took off is we played back-to-back games in November against Chicago and Toronto, and both of those games were sold out, and I realized hockey was going to take off in Philadelphia.
But just as momentum was building, Mother Nature had a surprise in store.
There was a bad storm came through in February, and we lost part of our roof.
Workmen went ahead, patching the 150 by 50-foot wide opening with fiberboard and tar paper. But while they were busy trying to restore the roof to its original state, a lot of people, including city officials, looked at the chunks of roofing scattered all over the grounds and parking lot and began to wonder whether the roof could really be considered safe at all.
We didn't expect we'd be playing on the road because of the roof falling off.
The last 29 games, we were like vagabonds. We played all over the country in various rinks.
Our home games were played in Canada, and I think we played one in Madison Square Garden, Quebec City, in Toronto. So it was just another road trip.
Despite the difficult circumstances, the Flyers went on to claim first place in their division. A 7-game playoff battle with the St. Louis Blues ensued, and though they lost that series, their first year was anything but a failure.
We hung in there and ended up in first place, and, you know, we're getting some real good crowds, and so it was a pretty good successful first year, I think.
However, it would be the Flyers' second season that forever changed the franchise when they found themselves facing the St. Louis Blues again come playoff time.
The St. Louis Blues, basically, they were a big physical team, and they would intimidate a lot of teams, and I would have to say that we were one of them.
They kicked the hell out of us in the playoffs. They just manhandled us.
When they swept us, I remember our owner, Ed Snyder, saying, this will never happen again to us.
They had a great vision, you know, and the vision was to structure the team so it wouldn't happen again.
One thing the Philadelphia Flyers were going to be known for is that no one was going to outmuscle us, beat us up, or be tougher than we were.
A few months later came the first step in changing the face of the team.
We drafted Bobby Clark, and that was really the turning point for our franchise. I was at the draft table, and it was a very interesting draft.
He slipped to us in the second round, and we couldn't believe it. And we took him, and I can remember after we took him, Jimmy Skinner come up to me and says, look it, you know, we'll give you three or four players for him. And Bud Boyle said, no way.
As soon as he arrived, you could see that he was the real deal. And every year he was getting better and better. And about the same time, we had Bill Barber and Jimmy Watson and Tom Bladen. And there was a big trade where we got Lonsbury and where we got Flett. And there was a lot of moves in a short period of time that added talent and also added a lot of toughness.
Don Selesky, Andre DuPont, and Bob Kelly were all part of Philadelphia's new rugged style. But it was the fists of Dave Schultz that changed the Flyers forever.
When he came up to us, he was a tough, big guy, and he loved to fight, and he took that role very quickly.
He was fearless, and the players get nicknames pretty quickly, and his nickname was the Hammer.
When you're challenged in any way, everyone can see what could might be going on, whether someone's trying to intimidate you or whatever. You've got to respond.
Schultz brought the Flyers the start of a physical presence that helped make us successful, I think.
Schultz is on him, wrestles him down.
Then a few other guys would join in. It would be like a little brawl.
During the 72-73 season where they really got physical, you know, and there was a road trip where they got involved with a big brawl, and then the next night they won the game just being physical and being dominant, and it was basically Jack Chevalier who was writing the story, and Pete Caffone was the headline writer, and they actually came up with Broad Street Bullies. It was used in a headline, and it just stuck.
At the time we were going through it, we never viewed ourselves as bullies or as a team that was out to intimidate other teams. It just sort of happened. The camaraderie that grew amongst the players and the way that we came together just evolved, and it evolved quickly.
Whatever we did, we always did it together. You never had a separation where five guys go one way, five guys go another, five go another.
Whoever got off the plane first, if that person had to go to the bathroom, we all went to the bathroom because we were like sheep.
There was no better than Bob Clark, who denied it every time, but he'd be sitting at the bar and a guy at the bottom of his drink would find some teeth there. Of course, Clark, you couldn't get away without, you know, you knew it was his at that point because he had to take them back and put them in his mouth.
That's how tight it was. Just little gags, you know, you're waiting for your luggage at the carousel, and all of a sudden you'd see all your clothes coming around. Well, somebody got a hold of your bag first, emptied it, and now you're standing there with people with all your clothes and personal belongings going around the carousel. So it was a lot of fun being with the guys.
The Flyers' unique brotherhood was nurtured by a unique man, Coach Fred Shiro.
He was the glue. He says, guys, I will treat you like men until you prove me different. And he was perfect for our mentality, our behavior, everything.
Freddie was ahead of his time, I really believe, in a lot of ways, in the ways exactly of studying video, instilling a system that would give you an opportunity to win.
I believe in precision and discipline, and that's the way I was brought up. Everything has to be exact. Everybody has to be on time. Everybody has to conform.
You know, I can remember Freddie Shiro sending letters to the wives and saying, right now, you're not going to feel number one. He's not going to look at you as you're the primary. The teammates, the team is going to be far more ahead of you. And don't take that personally, he would say, but the rewards will come.
Freddie's hockey brilliance was undeniable, but his personality and methods often left a lot of people wondering.
He put a bucket of water on the training table and left. He never said anything to us.
I remember asking Larry Goodenough, what's Freddie like? And he looked at me and said, you know, I couldn't tell you. I've never met the man.
And Freddie came back in, and he called Ricky McLeish, and he said, Ricky, come over here. I want you to roll up your sleeve. Ricky went over reluctantly and rolled up his sleeve. He said, I want you to put your hand in that bucket of water.
And he got the nickname The Fog from just wandering into rooms and suddenly being there in a restaurant or a bar and then suddenly disappearing.
So Ricky put his hand in the bucket of water and he says, now pull it out, pull it out. He said, see that hole that's left? And Ricky said, there ain't no hole there, Freddie. Freddie said, well, Ricky, that's how much we're going to miss you when you're gone.
Well, I think he wanted to be mysterious to his players, and I think that was very successful.
He would have us out there doing drills, and then all of a sudden, Clark, he'd say, you know, Fred, this makes no sense at all. He said, exactly. I was waiting for somebody to challenge him. So he would challenge us by things he did on the ice, but then what made it better yet, he'd come in and write his one-line slogans on the blackboard before we'd go out.
The mystery will go forever as to whether Freddie the Fog really was reality or was something that he created. Any of the players who played for him and any of the people who followed the Flyers during those years knows the guy was brilliant. So it's hard to envision a brilliant guy like that actually being in a fog, as they said.
A lot of teams dreaded the fact they had to come into Philadelphia and walk down the tunnel in the back and get dressed and go out and face the Philadelphia Flyers.
Our game, a lot of it was intimidation.
If you're tough, you play tough.
It was an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. We try to leave a message when we would lose and bang people a little harder just so they remember from the last time.
And we're not through yet. There's still pushing and shoving.
I can remember one time one of the guys started a big brawl in Philadelphia, and all you did was hang on to somebody that you knew so you wouldn't get the crap beat out here.
We caused a lot of havoc on the road. We didn't take a whole lot from anybody. And I think our reputation, it wasn't just me. I mean, it was our whole team.
O'Brien and Barber at it.
And wherever the Flyers went in those days, the buildings were sold out. Fans are just hollering and screaming at us, and I'm sure they're like they've thrown stuff.
Headline the LA Times, the animals are here. Lock your children up, they're loose.
There's a lot of buildings where we had to be taken into the building on a bus and also taken out of the building on the bus.
Everybody loved to hate us. We loved to be hated. It inspired us even more because going into somebody else's building and taking 2 points from them was all we wanted. We didn't care how, we didn't care where. It didn't matter, we just wanted to win the games.
The brawls were the sexy thing. They got most of the attention, and they were wild and they were crazy. But if you have the guys behind you, guys have your back, so to say, it's going to make the skilled players' jobs easier. And it is important to realize that the brawn with the skill is a lethal combination.
The Flyers' deadly mix produced a first-place finish, victories against the Flames and Rangers in the playoffs, and a matchup in the Stanley Cup Finals with their hated rival.
Bruins were the dynasty in the making. I mean, they had Bobby Orr, the best player in the game. They had Phil Esposito. They had these great players, and they had dominated.
The Flyers were the underdogs because we'd never been there before. We'd never done it before. And so a lot of things were pretty darn accurate in what was being said.
They hadn't won at Boston Garden since their very first game in the building. I mean, it had been ages. And how are the Flyers ever going to win the series if they couldn't win a game at Boston?
But there's one thing that was left out. And that's to a man. Every player in that room believed we were better than the Boston Bruins and that we were going to win the Cup.
Philadelphia's confidence showed in Game 1, but Bobby Orr's goal in the final minute provided the Bruins with another Boston Garden victory. The Flyers' troubles continued in Game 2 as they fell behind 2-0. But Captain Bobby Clark changed Philadelphia's fortunes.
Deflected to flat at the point. With a shot, it's goal! Bobby Clark on the tip in front and goes to Gilbert's leg for a goal.
Then, with less than a minute left.
Centering pass. Gilbert, he scores! Gilbert scores and Bruins set up. And Bruins gets the shuffle.
Andre Dupont's goal tied the game, sending it to overtime.
And it was really an up-and-down overtime period. I mean, both teams could have had 3 or 4 goals. I remember Johnny Busick walked in stone cold from the blue line in, and Perrault just got his block on him. And about 2 minutes later, we come back. And
Schultz behind the net, centers, flat, tries to Clark, shot, oh, rebound, score! Bobby Clark scores! Scores the game winner!
The overtime goal, I think, turned out to be important. We played them even the first game, we played them even the second game, and as the series was moving on, we were getting stronger.
Inspired by their Game 2 win, the Flyers returned home and dominated Game 3. Coach Shiro knew a Game 4 victory would push the Flyers to the brink of a Stanley Cup championship. He reminded his players of the sacrifices necessary to reach their goal in classic Freddie style, a chalkboard quote.
Win today, we will walk together forever. And I think that's a great quote. And boy, there's not a truer statement than that.
When you get involved in something like that, and certainly at the highest level, it's special.
Schultz and the Flyers responded to the message. They won Game 4, putting a stranglehold on the series.
The fifth game was in Boston. It was a total war. It was really a physical series. So we lose that game 5-1. The next game was back in Philadelphia on a Sunday afternoon.
It was pivotal that we won Game 6, because Game 7 in Boston would have been, oh, a huge climb.
To help ensure victory, the Flyers brought their good luck charm, Kate Smith, to the Spectrum. Her pregame rendition of God Bless America was a tradition started years earlier.
We had a vice president by the name of Lou Scheinfeld. And on his own, without really talking to anybody, he noticed that there were people that were not standing for the national anthem. So he decided to play God Bless America, Kate Smith's recording. And everybody stood up. And, of course, we went on to win the game. So I said to Lou, look, we won the game, so I never want to know when you're doing it. Just do it when you think you should. And he would pick specific games and play God Bless America, and our record was outstanding.
Well, when Kate Smith sang, the roof came off. If you don't get a few chills in your, and there's something wrong with you.
Well, I think it electrified pretty well everybody in the whole building. And once the building yard going, you know, it gets you going. You know, you're not really nervous, you're more like pumped up.
And shortly after Kate's stirring rendition,
we're in the right-hand corner, and I guess it was against Greg Shepard, and I won the draw back to Moose DuPont. I was lucky to tip it. I just changed directions enough to, you know, screw up the goaltender and go in the net.
The Flyers clung to their precarious lead as Bernie Parent made save after save.
It was in the third period, and we had a face-off in our end, and I skated by Phil Esposito, who was going to take the draw against Doris Kinderchuk, and Phil turned to me and he said, we're not going to score on that guy tonight. That was Bernie Parent. And you know, he instilled that kind of confidence in us. But when you not only instilled it in us, but intimidated a team or put that kind of doubt in a team's mind, that's pretty significant goaltending.
A short while later.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Flyers are going to win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers
fans that were outside in the parking lot listening to the games, when the game was over, the doors were opened. And that's the fans that came on the ice, because there was tons of fans. We couldn't really skate around.
People would not leave the building. They would not leave the area. And people from all over Philadelphia were coming down to the building.
You have to bring yourself back to Philadelphia in that time. The Eagles had won in 1960, and then it pretty much gone downhill ever since. The Sixers had one of the worst teams in history in the early 70s, and the Phillies weren't quite to the point where they started to grow into the mid-70s and into the late 70s. And so it was a sports town dying for a championship.
By the next morning, we were driving down to the University of Pennsylvania to meet the drivers in the cars for our parade, and people were just absolutely everywhere.
It turned out to be 2 million people. Just the whole city was just full of joy, you know. It was a beautiful thing.
Save.
Ed Belfour has been one of hockey's most successful and decorated goalies. His intensity and razor-sharp focus are every bit as legendary. But his professional career did not begin auspiciously. Belfour went undrafted despite a superlative senior season at the University of North Dakota that saw them win the national championship. Chicago finally signed him as a free agent, and by 1990, the Blackhawks had installed him as their number one goaltender.
Now Gretzky Steele has a breakaway, and on goal, he digs, he shoots, save is made by Belfour.
And a save by Belfour! How did he make that save?
Belfour, in turn, propelled them to the top of the standings. In a rookie season that ranks with the very best, Belfour won 43 games in 74 starts, recorded 4 shutouts, and a goals against average of 2.47. He captured the Calder Trophy as the league's best rookie, the Vezina Trophy as top goalie, and shared the Jennings Trophy for the lowest goals against average. Belfour was also nominated for the Hart Trophy as NHL MVP.
Spectacular performance by Ed Belfour.
Since that season, he has set personal milestones that rank among the best of all time. But it all began with a very special rookie season.
The Flyers and the city of Philadelphia reveled in the magnificence of a Stanley Cup victory. Yet others felt the champions were a fluke.
It's supposed to take a lot of time to develop a championship team, not 6 or 7 years. And for the Flyers to climb that high, that quickly, I don't think a lot of people believed in them.
But Keith Allen did. If the champs were to repeat, he knew more firepower was necessary. In another brilliant move, he acquired sharpshooter Reggie Leach from California. Leach was paired with his junior teammate Bobby Clark and Bill Barber on the top line. Their success was instantaneous, earning them the nickname, the LCB line.
The Clark, the Leach, shot, score!
Leach going in, he's in, the score! Leach ties it up for Philadelphia, that didn't take long.
Leach's 45 goals would lead Philadelphia that year as they returned to the Stanley Cup Finals. The Flyers challenged this time the Buffalo Sabres, led by the French Connection.
What we wanted to do was prove that the first year wasn't a fluke. So it was important to us. We'd kind of owned Buffalo. I guess it was kind of the similar situation where Boston figured they owned us the year before. We owned Buffalo at the time, and we felt very confident that we could win.
The Flyers' ownership of Buffalo continued as they took the first two games at home. The Sabres would need a miracle to get back in the series. Game three would be that and more.
Flyers jumped to an early lead, and as the game went along, the steam started rising up from the ice.
The Odd was one of those old buildings that was not air-conditioned, and they couldn't control the heat and humidity. And the fog got so thick that literally the goalies couldn't see the blue line. So shots were coming at them from basically, you know, out of the fog.
The uncommon now seemed common.
This thing comes out of the ceiling, and it was a bat. And Jim Lorenz took his stick and knocked it out of the air and knocked it down, and it was kind of withering there on the ice, and Ricky McLeish took his glove off and picked it up, and I said, Ricky, you could get rabies from that damn thing, and Ricky said, what are rabies?
The fog persisted, and so did the Sabres. They erased one Flyers lead after another and sent the game into overtime when...
Farrell coming to center, dumps it off the boards in the corner, Robert going after it, he scores!
Did get a little dicey when they won the fog game in overtime and then followed that up with a win. Now, if the Sabres had just won the game in the fog and then the Flyers had come back and won game four and gone up 3-1, then okay, it was a fluke because of the fog. But when Buffalo then won the game four as well, I mean, you're talking about a situation where this series has been turned around and is dead even. But the Flyers are pretty dominant in game five.
A 5-goal outburst pushed Philadelphia to the brink of another Stanley Cup.
I can remember the late Punch Imlach. He said, I'll tell you right now,
that our Buffalo Sabres will be back in Philly for the seventh game.
Punch's prediction emboldened the Sabres as they battled Philadelphia for every inch of the ice in Game 6. The game remained scoreless until the third period.
And I remember I got the puck and from Jimmy Watson. Watson gave it to me, and I dumped it off the corner, and Kelly and got it, and he... And we were always taught by Freddie to come around and just tuck it.
Kelly has it. Oh, Freddie scores! Bob Kelly for Kent, the basic kick, and the Flyers are on the board. It's 1-0. The Hound does it again. Oh, oh, oh. Kivachuk blocks it, and it comes to the near side. Kivachuk back to Clever, the breakaway. He scores! Bill Clement for Kent, the basic kick, and it's 2-0 Flyers. Clement mobbed by his whole bench. As the Flyers come out en masse.
It's not always about the key guys scoring the goals. What it is, it's the other players that chip in to get you over the hump. But I think that was the case in that game. I think Billy Clement's goal was kind of the icing on the cake goal.
It's all over. The Flyers have won their second in a row. The Flyers have won their second consecutive Stanley Cup. And the whole Flyers bench is off the ice.
It's just incredible that for the second time, second year in a row, we were the world champion. And, you know, when you look at this, you look at the earth we live on, and you see that year you're the world champion. It's a beautiful thing.
I think it was validation to a certain degree, but we knew that we were more than, quote, quote, the Broad Street Bullies. But as far as, I guess, saying, hey, you know, we did it once, call it lucky, call it a fluke, you do it twice, you're a pretty darn good team, and that's what we felt we were.
I think the second time we won it, a lot of us, because we were flying back to Philly, took the time to spend a couple hours and enjoy the feelings. We sat with our teammates and enjoyed the winning, because you're always scared it's never going to happen again.
The love affair between Philadelphia and the Flyers was now cemented forever. Many hoped for a third parade in 1976. But before the Flyers had an opportunity to deliver another cup, they faced an even greater challenge.
This was 1976. This was the height of the Cold War. The relations between the U.S. and the Soviets were very, very cold at that time. They brought the Russian teams, came over to play an eight-game series.
They sent two teams, the Red Army team and the Soviet wings. The Red Army team was, except for one line and one defense pair, was the national team. And they had four games in NHL team and not beaten them yet.
We were the defending Stanley Cup champions, and we were the last game in the series. And they came to play us, and probably the first time in our history that the entire hockey world was rooting for us, because we were known as bad boys in those days, and nobody really cared for us that much. And here we were playing the Russians, and everybody wanted us to win.
Shiro had a really, really good plan for how to play the Russians. He'd studied them for years and years and years, and he had a team that was the antithesis of Russian hockey, but he knew how to counter what they do.
And Shiro's plan at that time was just stay in your position, let them pass it around. They got to bring it to you. So the first time they got the puck, you know, they're whipping it around the ice. And it looked pretty, but we weren't chasing it, so they had nowhere to go, and they become discouraged real quickly.
And then all of a sudden,
over the line on the right wing, Holmes looking for a man up the slot. Palava, it's up by Bennett.
He looked like he got hit by a bazooka and went down.
But it was a good hit. It was a message being sent, and we made our point. Okay, you went through the league. Now you're facing, in my opinion, was the best team in the league.
This is incredible. The Soviet Army team is going back to the locker room. They are leaving. They are walking out. And they're taking their sticks with them.
They were very upset. They thought it was a dirty hit. And, of course, I left my seat immediately and ran down to the locker room. And Alan Eagleson was there representing the Players Association. And Clarence Campbell was there, the president of the National Hockey League. And I said, what's going on? And they said, they won't come back on the ice. I said, tell them we're not going to pay them if they don't come back. And sure enough, they mumbled to each other in Russian, and they came back on the ice.
All right, Leach, with no scores, the Flyers on the power play. Into the left wing corner, the old face. LeBuck go there first, ties to ice. Back to the point, Barber dumps it in, and then it's goal! Leach, and a tip in for the Flyers.
I remember the goal because I was the one that took the shot and Reggie tipped it in. And then we got the ball rolling. And then we never looked back.
Up the ice, and we have a breakaway from McLean. He'll go right in on the shot. Score! McLean, what a great play!
Sileski on the right wing. Sileski, the drive. Swing, great rebound!
Joe Watson, the Smithers Thundermouth, who gets maybe one or two or three a year, but Denmark, the Flyers using the Soviet.
In those days, the defense didn't do that very often. Particularly Joe Watson, who was terrific defensive defenseman, but very rarely scored. I think Shiro told him he set hockey back 10 years.
And the game is over. The final score, the Philadelphia Flyers 4 and the Soviet Army 1. A beautiful masterpiece of a performance.
The whole hockey world was thrilled because we totally dominated them. And in Pravda, in Russia, there was a big cartoon with this big, giant guy with a club with the Flyers logo on it beating up on a little Russian, and I loved it.
Hi. For tax now.
Although many of the names synonymous with the Cup years were gone by the 1979-80 season, there were plenty of new heroes for Flyers fans to cheer on.
Ben Wilson was in, Kenny Linsman, Paul Holmgren. We had Bays, Barnes, Buzniak, you know, they call them the three Bs. Pat Quinn was the coach.
I don't care where, if you put your stick down, just put her down. If you're going to be able to try to shoot, that alone is not going to get a shot off.
He let them crisscross, gave them a lot more freedom, and it just clicked from day one.
They win a game, then they get just hammered in Atlanta. I mean, just hammered at the old Omni, big Flames team.
We're outside the Omni in Atlanta, and I remember like this, it was yesterday, and I'm along with Pat Quinn, and Pat looks at me, she's a tough night. But I said, I really like our team.
We bounced back with a big win, and obviously over the next few months, nobody could have expected what happened.
Everything that could go right went right, and it was an adventure virtually every night, and a new hero coming across every night.
They had four lines that were absolutely relentless, and they played so much in the other team's end. They won a lot of 6-4 games. They won a lot of 5-3 games.
We had some injuries. We didn't have the full lineup, but that's how we played as a team.
You had the feeling that it didn't matter what we did, we were either going to win it or tie it. I can recall a couple games we were 2 goals behind with 3 minutes to go, and we knew we were going to tie it. And that's how confident we got going.
And then the other fact, we had Pete Peters in net, who was a rookie, was absolutely phenomenal.
And Phil Muir was our other goalie, and he played extremely well, too.
Well, the record-breaking game in Boston, of course, it was in the Garden, where the Flyers had little success over the years because Boston was such a powerhouse.
It was like a playoff game, like a Stanley Cup final game. Boston didn't want us to get that victory in their building, and we wanted it, and we were a pretty dominant team in that particular game.
Trying to get away from Clark. Loses. Clark fires and scores. And it's back left point. Watson. Score! Jimmy Watson. Back to Barber. Fires. Scores. Bill Barber.
That was a perfect game. And they would throw perfect games once a week in this thing, but this was terrific because the Flyers hadn't had great success in Boston previous to winning, you know, the Cup, obviously. That had been a house of horrors for them. And that house of horrors turned into another crowning achievement for them.
To do it in Boston Garden was just what a feeling. The fans at the end of that game gave us a nice standing ovation, which I thought was really nice of them, appreciating how we had played and what we had accomplished.
There you go, Bobby Clark. Good game, boys. Damn it, that's the way, boys. Hard work. Came a long way.
Philadelphia's streak continued, reaching an astonishing 35 games without a loss. A record unmatched in all sports. But even the Flyers were bound to lose sometime.
The odds are definitely with the North Stars tonight. We will do it. Guarantee it.
And it was a freezing cold night at the old Met, and it started. And it was obvious this, it was all going to end at once. And one goal, two goals, three goals. And there was no magic coming back from the Flyers. They'd run out of all that mysticism.
They scored four or five power play goals against us in that game. Just happened where one after the other, it just snowballed after a while. And probably a lot of relief on the players, just like wondering when it was ever going to end. But 35 games without a loss was amazing.
I find that hard to believe it'll ever be touched again. And I'll never say never, but it's going to be a difficult thing to try to do to match that team's success in that period of time.
After slumping towards the end of that streak season, they played pretty well in the playoffs. They'd eliminated the Rangers in five and had beaten the North Stars in five and sailed in looking like their old selves.
Well, we're about set to go. The Stanley Cup, the Philadelphia Flyers against the New York Islanders.
I think we're fairly evenly matched going in, and they must have had close to 20 power play goals in that series. It was just unbelievable how well their power play clicked. They picked us apart.
Costly penalties, a referee's error, and injuries all undermined the Flyers despite their best efforts.
Coming in with Nystrom. Tonelli to Nystrom. He scores! Bob Nystrom scores the goal. The Islanders win the Stanley Cup.
You can't look at excuses. We did go into overtime. We needed to score the overtime winner and didn't get that accomplished.
That's what happens. Some days you get a good balance, sometimes you don't. So, you know, we don't cry over spilt milk. It would have been nice with a 35-game unbeaten streak, but, you know, it didn't happen, so you live with it.
Philadelphia continued to strive for another championship during the early 80s, but were unable to deliver. Times were changing, and so was the roster. By the end of the 1984 season, the organization's heart and soul was ready to retire.
He hated to lose. You're on the ice, he'd give a yell at you, he'd scream at you, he'd spear you, practice, so he got mad at you. He didn't care. He just, all he wanted to do was win.
That ovation kind of hits you right in the heart at how much he's meant to this Philadelphia area over the years.
You wish you didn't have to go through something like that, because it means the end of playing hockey. And for me, that was the most important thing in my life, other than my family, of course. But when you get an ovation like that, it's so special.
And now, as the number 16 banners are unfurled, I ask you to join me in saying, thank you, Bob, we love you.
Team raises your jersey, it's so special. Those types of things are lifelong memories for you, special lifelong memories.
I will cherish forever this evening, and if I had my choice, I'd love to do it over again.
After four unsuccessful postseasons, Flyers management rejuvenated the team with a strong crop of rookies, including Derek Smith, Murray Craven, Peter Zezel, and Rick Tocchet.
Tocchet was so, so important. Zezel became a superstar in this town because of his looks, and the women just loved him. It was like going to see a rock star, and that was just part of the whole aura of that young team.
The talented youngsters meshed quickly with veterans such as Mark Howe, Tim Kerr, and Dave Poulin. The final piece of the puzzle was to hire a head coach to lead them. Surprisingly, the Flyers chose Mike Keenan, a relative unknown, to take the reins.
Mike Keenan came in, and you're thinking, he better be as good as he presents himself. I don't know if he copied Scotty Bowman's jaw going up like this, but he had the jaw going, and he had the chewing ice like Scotty, and I'm like, boy, this guy better be something like Scotty, or it's going to be a disaster. These guys will be all over him.
Keenan was an intense personality who didn't hesitate to berate his players, rookies and veterans alike.
Let's go, let's go, let's go!
right there, Timmy Buddy. Center, center, talking.
While not everyone welcomed his methods, on the ice, the team responded, making a late season run and capturing a division title.
Mike Keenan treated players like a container of toothpaste. You know how you think there's nothing left, but you always get a little bit more? Mike Keenan would squeeze that little bit more when you think there was nothing left.
Perhaps the single most important player on Keenan's resilient Flyers was the team's young goalie.
Pelle Lindbergh really carried the Flyers hockey team. He played a lot like Bernie Perrant. He wasn't a huge goaltender, but he had great reflexes and was able to cut the angle down very, very well.
Lindbergh led the Flyers into the playoffs, where they defeated the New York Rangers and the New York Islanders in the first two rounds. In the conference championship, the Flyers took a 3-2 lead on the Quebec Nordiques and looked to put the series on ice. Game 6, they found themselves down two men and struggling to hold the lead.
The left side to Marois, back to Spassky. Short-handed breakaway by Dave Cullen. He's going right on in. Shoot! Score!
Well, I think that killed Quebec right then and there, and we ended up winning the series, but that's a goal that I think every fan will remember for a long time.
The Flyers would finally meet their match in the finals as they faced off against Wayne Gretzky and the defending Stanley Cup champion Edmonton Oilers. Several of Philadelphia's key players were injured. Though they managed to win the first game, the Oilers stormed back, taking 4 straight and seizing their second Stanley Cup championship.
Gretzky has got it up high.
We, not healthy, just couldn't play with them. That was just the bottom line to the whole thing. They were just too good.
Although the season ended in disappointment, the team had recaptured the Flyer spirit. And Pelle Lindbergh was awarded the Vezina Trophy as the league's best goalie. In a touching ceremony, the award was presented by Lindbergh's mentor, Flyer great Bernie Perrant.
First of all, I want to thank my teammates. Without them, this wouldn't be possible. But the man I really want to thank tonight is the guy standing to the left of me, Bernie Perrant. He told me everything I know about to play about hockey in America. Thank you, Bernie.
I had the pleasure to work with him for 3 or 4 years, and became like a son to me. And I really care. He was a good person, a great goalie, but he's a good person. I loved him.
Pelle was a person that just loved life. A real fun-loving guy that everybody liked.
He was like this big kid, and he had every toy you could ever imagine. That's why I loved Pelle. It was all a big game. It was fun. It was just a blast. I never met a player who just had such a good time.
With Lindbergh in net, Philadelphia's hopes could not have been higher as they entered the 1986 season. Mike Keenan had everything in place for another run at the Cup, and the team wasted little time rushing out to a 12-2-0 record.
Unbelievable!
After Keenan's first year, the team goes to finals. Everything's like bright future for the Flyers, and then
this is the red Porsche Lindbergh was driving. The condition of the car tells the tragic story.
Driving home in the early morning of November 10th, Pelle Lindbergh crashed his sports car and was killed. His death stunned and saddened the hockey community and devastated the Flyers family.
Looking over there this morning and seeing the empty cell is probably one of the toughest things that I've had to do in hockey, and I know that this morning was the toughest practice I've ever gone to.
Outside the Spectrum, American and Swedish flags hung at half-mast.
That was a big blow to our organization. Personally, we really were very fond of Pelle, and he was a phenomenal, phenomenal young goalie.
The Flyers honored their fallen teammate, then tried valiantly to play on. But the reality of Lindbergh's death took a heavy emotional toll.
I think it was about 6 days after his death. I think we had a game against Edmonton. We were playing at home, and I remember I scored a goal in the first period, and I came to the bench and almost cried.
For a lot of these guys, it was their first kind of situation with death. And I'm including grandparents. These are young kids. And Keenan try to kind of gather the troops and kind of pull him through this, and he did as good a job as he can, but this was a brother just taken away from them. And though they, you know, they played through, if you will, it wasn't the same. That whole year was the year Pally Lindbergh was killed.
After the trauma of the 86 season, Philadelphia was looking for a new start the following year. The re-energizing force the Flyers craved was found in a dynamic young goalie named Ron Hextall.
Nobody had ever seen anybody like Hextall before. We had guys that could carry the puck. I mean, Jokinen could handle the puck. Cheevers could handle the puck, but nobody could fire the puck.
Hexy was an intense guy. I don't know, he burned up a lot of energy before the game even started.
He almost scared you watching him because he would rock back and forth in his stall, and he was mentally so focused on the game.
Hextall's aggressive attitude harkened back to Flyers of old.
Chevrier is just getting murdered by Philadelphia's Hextall.
He wasn't just physically tough, but mentally tough, refusing to bow to any opponent.
Gretzky had a big-time chance late in the game, and Hextall stoned him, and Gretzky looked at him and says, "Who the hell are you?" And Hextall shot right back, "Who the hell are you?"
Shot, save by Philadelphia's Hextall. Olchek in, pass, oh, and Hextall stopped it.
He was just raw emotion in goal. You didn't see that previous here, and people loved him. They just loved him.
With Hextall's contagious fire fueling them, the Flyers were once again a force to be reckoned with. Philadelphia steamrolled through the regular season and captured another Patrick Division title.
Back to Brown, score! Beautiful!
Great outlet pass by Ron Hextall.
He played so well that whole first year for our Flyers club that he gave everybody a lift.
The Flyers' euphoria would not last long. As they turned their eyes to the finals, they would come face to face with a very familiar, very powerful foe.
We saw these guys 2 years ago, this Gretzky and Curry, and here they come again, but they're 2 years better. Now what?
As many expected, the mighty Oilers, at the peak of their powers, swarmed the Flyers and took three of the first four contests.
Unless the Flyers come up with a big game on Tuesday night, it may be the last minute of the Spectrum season.
And we were down 3-1. We went up there, and I remember we picked up the paper, and they had the parade set for the next day. And that was a pretty good motivator for a hockey club.
I think at that time, you know, Edmonton's maybe a little overconfident, and that thought we were just a bunch of, you know, grinders and stuff like that. But we hadn't quit, and, you know, we were going to go after them.
Despite the Flyers' intentions, early in Game 5, it appeared as if the Oilers would have their championship parade.
And it's going to be difficult to come back against them.
But the Flyers would not quit. They came back to tie the score. And in the third, Rick Tocchet put home the game winner.
Steal behind the net in front. Tocchet scores!
Back in Philly for Game 6, the Flyers, battered and bruised, again fell behind. But as they had done so many times, Philadelphia battled back. Late in the third period, defenseman J.J. Daigneau took his place in Flyer history.
The Oilers to the point. Daigneau's out. Score!
Boy, okay, these people are going crazy.
That place rocked for about 10 minutes straight, and it felt like it could cave in.
You know, I really had a feeling after Game 6 that we were going to win because we just kept coming back and coming back, and we seemed to have, you know, that character and that resiliency, and we just wouldn't die. I mean, they had to be getting on their plane after that game, going back to Edmonton, feeling like, you know, these guys just won't go away.
Although they were confident, the Flyers were physically and mentally exhausted. For two periods, they went toe-to-toe with the Oilers. Ron Hextall was magnificent, stopping what seemed to be a never-ending barrage of shots.
Hextall's been strong for the Flyers tonight.
Hexy just stood on his head, and like I say, he almost won a Stanley Cup all by himself.
But then they just started to come at us in waves. They got the first one, and you know, they got one more, and then it wasn't until about 4 or 5 minutes left that Glenn Anderson scored to make it 3-1 that kind of dimmed our hopes for the Cup.
And ladies and gentlemen, the Edmonton Oilers have won the 1987 Stanley Cup.
I thought we were going to win that game, the final game. After that game, it was like getting kicked in the gut 20 times. And I still relive that game. I think, man, if we'd have won that game.
I saw a lot of full-grown men, tough hockey players, crying their eyes out because we lost the Stanley Cup Finals. And when I look back on it, I know why they were crying, because they thought maybe that was the only chance they had to get to the finals.
Those who have seen this series will say you should have seen the one in 87 with the Oilers and the Flyers.
That team, they never won a cup, but they remain a very special team. They didn't win it all, which is usually how everything's measured by in Philadelphia. There's no rings, but boy, that team tried their backside off every night. And that's sort of the measuring stick now. Give me the effort that those teams in the 80s gave me. Give me the electricity that those teams gave me. Make it so that I want to go down to that place and I'm going to be on the edge of my seat, because I don't know what's going to happen, but something's going to happen.
I'd like to show you the most versatile.
It's intercepted by Gallant in front, redirected. Yzerman scores!
Well, the Flyers really look down and out right now.
When the Flyers bottomed out in the early 90s, their first step back up was a trade they made when Eric Lindros came along.
That trade for Lindros, I mean, it's obviously probably one of the biggest ones in the history, him and Wayne.
He came in here with an awful lot of fanfare, an awful lot of pressure. And in his early years, he lived up to all that.
He's one of the great talents to ever play for that team. Just the stuff he could do. It was just amazing, the strength he had, the physical powers on the ice.
Oh! He was the first building block of the Flyers as they arose again in the 90s.
Prior to the 1995 season, former defenseman Terry Murray returned to the Flyers as head coach and immediately focused on restoring the team's playoff pride.
There was urgency for the Flyers to make the playoffs after 5 years of missing the playoffs. And when we got those first 10 games of the season underway and things weren't going the way we wanted, Clarkie made a great trade with Montreal, and we ended up getting John LeClair and Eric Desjardins.
Instantaneously after the trade happened, and they went from pretender to contender, almost like a switch was flipped.
Over the line, look at that, LeClair right on in, shoots, high score!
Johnny LeClair wasn't a big scorer when he came. He had potential, but you didn't know that he was like this volcano about to erupt.
John LeClair, welcome to Philadelphia. The fans love you already.
Feeding off their new teammates' energy, the Flyers regained the swagger of years past.
Hey, this is like the old Philadelphia Flyers.
Yeah, this is the Broad Street Bullies we got back. Since the trade, the Flyers have been dynamite.
It wouldn't take long for number 10 to elevate his game and help form one of the most dynamic scoring lines in history with one of history's most memorable nicknames.
Them the Legion of Doom, you should call them the Eclipse. You can't see the sun in front of you.
Folks, you're looking at the best line in hockey right now. This is the top line in the sport.
If that was your job that night to cover those guys, you knew at the end of the night you were going to be completely exhausted.
Scary sometimes to play against those guys because they were physical.
They were big, they were strong, they were fast.
They could go around you, but they could go through you and over you too.
It was just a scary line to be playing against.
Lindros steamrolling people, LeClair knocking people out of the way to score goals.
Renberg, with his speed and quickness down the wing, boy, he was an explosive player.
Ahead for Renberg on the breakaway. Renberg scores!
That line just gelled well together.
I give them the puck and it would make things happen.
Led by the Legion, Philadelphia returned to glory and dramatically closed out the regular season against their newest rival.
The Devils had been kind of a nemesis. They were an emerging nemesis.
John LeClair tried to tuck a pass in front. Renberg battling for it. Oh, the puck score! It is in, and Philadelphia has won in overtime.
They won won it. They were champs, and it seemed like just a couple months earlier that they were looking like a team that might be really headed for a long, long drought, but it turned around that quickly.
We made the playoff my first year, and it was a great feeling.
In the playoffs, they played the Sabres and then blew the Rangers out.
Flyer team has come a long way under Bobby Clark in a real hurry, haven't they?
Boy, did they ever turn around their season.
The Flyers dethroned the Rangers when they were Stanley Cup champions in a startling sweep.
The Devils would get their revenge in the Eastern Conference Finals, putting an end to Philadelphia's storybook season.
And a terrific run for the Flyers.
We came close to really doing a lot of good things in that first year.
That summer at the NHL Awards, league MVP Eric Lindros issued a heartfelt statement to the Flyers faithful.
Thank you to the fans of Philadelphia who have supported us when we weren't so good. We're getting better, and we're going to do it.
Just 2 years later, the Flyers would embark on yet another successful playoff run.
To change things, here's a rebound. Score! Brindamore! The Flyer fans celebrate. It takes four rounds. The Flyers are going to get to the fourth round.
Congratulations to Terry Murray, the Philadelphia Flyers, and their fans. This is one heck of a hockey club that's going to represent the East.
All of Philadelphia believed this was the year the Flyers would bring Lord Stanley home. Standing in their way would be the Western Conference champion, Detroit Red Wings.
Most everyone I talked to felt the Flyers were going to win that series.
I thought, boy, the way this hockey club's playing right now, Detroit can't play. Just can't play it.
And you got there and it took about two periods to say, whoa, that's something special over there.
We let a couple of bad goals in the first two games at home, and then we just never really got it going.
The Red Wings have taken the Flyers' game plan and ripped it up.
They beat us four straight, they dominated us, and we really weren't in the series right from the start.
The 1997 Detroit Red Wings are Stanley Cup champions.
As it turned out, the Red Wings were a very good team that I think a lot of people underestimated. The Flyers, this was supposed to be their moment, but the Red Wings got in the way.
Listen closely. I have important news that may be of great...
The 97 Cup run was the apex for the Legion of Doom. And although the team never made it back to the finals, the Flyers still provided their fans with some memorable moments.
We're throwing everything we have at the Pittsburgh Penguins. Both teams are battling back and forth.
We got into overtime, and our locker room was full of characters at that time. Rick Tocchet, Keith Jones, Craig Berube. Guys who really knew how to keep a locker room on an even keel. And as the period started to go by, the overtime period started to go by, it became more humorous as we went along.
Put on another pot of coffee. This game could be on ESPN Classic before it's over.
After a while, you don't even know what time it is. You don't know how many periods you've played.
It just went on and on and on. And then it's like Groundhog Day. It was the same thing at both ends of the ice.
By the third overtime period, we were running out of Powerade. We're running out of power bars. Guys wanted to order pizza.
They delivered pizza.
Ate a lot of pizza.
We're eating pizza to try to keep our energy up.
What you do remember is there's more pizza waiting for you to eat.
Gary Dornoff was actually eating some pizza, and all of a sudden our producer says, "You guys are on." We turn around, and I'm talking, and I look over, and I see there's actually some pizza here.
Some guys had their blow dryer going on their skates.
Guys getting intravenous put in, getting fluids back in their body.
We're looking for popcorn, whatever we could get our hands on to eat.
There was a lot of great stories. I mean, Keith Jones was hilarious on the bench.
I can remember actually going on for a shift, standing at center ice right in front of our bench and looking one way, looking the other way, and saying, change.
He jumped back on the bench and told Craig Ramsey, the coach, don't put me out there again, I'm done.
Who's going to be the hero tonight in Pittsburgh?
Two other times earlier in the game, I'd gone wide on Darius Kasparaitis, only to be cut off at the net or cut off behind the net. So I faked like I was going to go outside on him again, and as he crossed his feet over, I was able to pull a puck back on my forehand and get a shot off.
Raymond
goes deep with it. Stops the shot. He's good.
I think Ron Tugnut was just as tired because the shot, although it looks great, it probably hit the middle bar in the net, and it was a great feeling. It was exhilarating, and our guys were just excited it was over.
Well, I remember Sammy Kapanen getting hit so hard by Darcy Tucker, he was dazed.
Kapanen was out cold on his feet.
He was up, but he was skating back towards the middle of the ice.
He doesn't know where he is. He's staggering toward the middle of the ice.
I was able to get my stick out and kind of direct him to the bench.
And the Flyers, in the meantime, are in their own zone, and they're pinned in. And it's a shooting gallery around the Flyer net, and it looks like Toronto's going to win the game.
But then all of a sudden, Jeremy Roenick picks up the puck, goes down the wing.
Look out here, 2-on-1. Roenick, Avanti, Roenick shoots. He scores! Jeremy Roenick has propelled the Flyers to the Eastern Conference Finals.
And they would advance to battle the Tampa Bay Lightning. Game 6 would provide another unforgettable moment.
2 minutes left to go in the third period. Tampa Bay leading at 4-3. Primo down to the wing of Tamander. A shot.
The tying goal was more fluke than anything, kicking it with my skate over to the other side of the net.
Keith Primo has dramatically tied this game.
You know, it's hard to believe there's 40 years involved here, but I'll say it is 40 years of a great organization.
Primo draws it, side of the net, right shot.
For me, it's my life.
To be known as a Flyer is an honor. It really is a privilege.
To me, it is tradition, winning, pride, all the things it takes, character.
If I had a choice, there would be no other place in the world I'd play except for the Flyers. I have played with other clubs. You know, I played with Boston, Oakland, Detroit. And I know I don't even mention them. They always say, who did you play with? I said, Philadelphia Flyers.
Loyalty, commitment, dedication. Rare words today. Rarer still when applied to a sports franchise. But then again, for 40 years, the Philadelphia Flyers have always been more than simply a hockey team.
The Flyers are a family. You know, starting right from the very beginning when Ed put those original teams together. And, you know, Ed Snyder has been here right from the beginning. You just don't see that in sports. And he set the tone.
He loved his players. He would do anything he could for them. And to this day, he's still doing the same thing.
And another look at Ed Snyder. 4 decades, he's been putting his heart and soul into this franchise.
I'll never forget when I first turned pro. I wanted to settle in Philadelphia. I made it that I wanted to be there, and Mr. Snyder helped me personally to purchase a house, even though I couldn't quite afford it at that time, that we could make it work a little bit later on, and I've never forgotten that.
I worked a few years in Minnesota and a year in Florida and always come back, and because of Mr. Snyder, the people that worked here, the players were always treated special, and it was always team.
I spent a long time in the American League, and I was fortunate enough to win down there 4 times. And when you can do it better than anybody else, it is the ultimate, and I know it's the American League. They have a chance at the Stanley. That is our goal here. We're going to build a team that has this bond that can get it done, and as a kid, if I could have picked a place to win, it'd be here. So that's our goal, and that's our intent, and we're not going to stop until we get it done.
The city of Philadelphia, to me, is the greatest sports city in North America. And I know that's a huge statement, but when I look at the Philadelphia Flyers and the way the support has been and the energy that the fans have brought to this team over the years since 1967 has just been absolutely incredible.
They're as passionate a fan as there is in sports. I don't think there's any doubt about it.
It's a blue-collar city, and all they ask for is hard work.
That's what Philly's all about. It's gritty, it's hardworking, it's got an edge and a chip. And that's what we've been as the Flyers.
The fans love this stuff in Philadelphia. If there's a rink in the NHL that the fans appreciate this more than anyone, it's here in Philadelphia.
You know, when things are going well, they're unbelievable, and you know, they know their hockey, so when things are going bad, you know, they get on your case.
Even if we didn't win, if we worked really hard and put in an effort, the people are always there behind us.
It's nice to go to a city where you can play, feel like you belong, live thereafter, have a career, and get to know a lot of people outside of hockey. This is probably going to be my home for the rest of my life.
The fans in this city are not just hockey fans. Most importantly, they are Flyer fans, and they want to see us win every night.
In Philadelphia, if you do something good, they'll never forget you, and they've never forgotten us.
This is one of the greatest hockey franchises that will ever be in the National Hockey League, in my mind.
The only thing they can expect from this organization is that we'll work as hard as anybody else, any other organization, will do everything humanly possible to win the Cup.